Thank Barcamp for putting this together. Wouldn't be possible without the organizers, and you know, we've already done the thank yous for them, but one more quick mention. And another thank you, of course, to you. That's supposed to be a mirror. If y'all aren't interested, then this wouldn't be possible either, so that's another another big one. But enough about you, let's talk about me. Real quickly, I'm born and raised in New Orleans. At the moment, I'm up in Washington, D.C. I go to Georgetown University. And last semester, I worked at a place called the Center for New Designs in Learning and Scholarship. And this was a campus center that studied the way people learn and the way that technology is playing a role in the way people are learning. And this really sparked my interest in how education is moving into the digital age. And that brings me to my topic. Learning is social. We're social beings. Everything we do is social. Not only do we want to learn in groups, but we're actually better at it. And what we're increasingly finding is that, be it in a formal or informal setting like this one, the web is really a good place to learn. And we've seen that with the transition to Web 2.0, we're finding an explosion of tools that help us learn and bring us together to learn. And so you have the Web 1.0 was just a static source of information. It was a place where you went to find something. Then we get to Web 2.0 and we find this environment. Instead of a source of information, it's a dynamic place where we go to share, an explosion of user-created content. And the penultimate example of this is, of course, the wiki. It's kind of the grandfather of them all. A wiki is a living, breathing document where we come together to share what we know, and it really ends up being a source of information where the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. Everyone contributes something, but in the end you have this really cool collaborative project. Now, of course, when you say wiki, the first thing we all think of is Wikipedia. But it's important to realize that a wiki goes really far beyond this. Take the Barcamp website, for example. This organization on a national level is organized by a wiki. I mean, you'll see there, I tried to circle. Anyone is allowed to come in and edit this. It's not controlled by any one individual. It's really a collaboration of all the minds that are interested in this. So a quick story about my wiki. I took part in a sort of experiment this past semester at school where we had a big group of people coming together to construct a wiki about participatory learning and how people learn in groups. So you had this group of people each doing individual research and then coming back and making this group product. And it was kind of interesting because while we were collaborating online and forging this document, we were also meeting together in person. So we had this kind of merger of two worlds. And what we really found is that it was honestly sort of a mess. The process at first ended up being a bunch of people copying and pasting chunks that they found on the web into this document. A lot of cramming, and I just kind of gave up hope in the beginning. I didn't think it was ever going to come together. But after a while, not only did it end up becoming a really cool document, it was 30 pages long, comprehensive, well-organized, but a sort of cool phenomenon emerged from it. And that was that very few of us did a lot of work, and the rest of everyone else kind of observed and maybe contributed a little bit. But what I call the distribution of authorship is really not even at all. And you find the same thing in Wikipedia. They actually published their statistics. I don't have it offhand, but it's something like 90% of the edits done on Wikipedia are done by 10% of the users. And so you find it really driven by the top, the people who are really motivated and interested in it. And then the rest are observers. They take things in. So that was kind of the interesting phenomenon that emerged. But nonetheless, we got this product in the end that was really greater than anything that one of us could have individually created. And that brings me to kind of my first point, which is that the Web 2.0 fosters collaborative thinking. The tools that it gives us allows us to learn in a community, to share in a way that we really couldn't do before. Another tool that fosters collaborative thinking is DIGO, which I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with. And I like DIGO for two reasons. First of all, it's a useful tool. It allows you to highlight on the web, to bookmark, and more importantly, share your bookmarks and highlights with a group. It has a you get a cloud folder, and say you have five people working on a project. Instead of emailing links back and forth, they're in a cloud folder in one source for people to share. But really, the more interesting part about DIGO is what they call stickies. When you have a DIGO account, you get the DIGO toolbar in your browser, and it lets you leave little post-it notes on the web. And anyone else who has DIGO can see these post-it notes that you've left. So it's almost like a dog leaving his mark somewhere. You're looking around the web, you go to any web page, and if you have the DIGO turned on, you can see the notes that people have left there. And so it's kind of this weird feeling that people have been there before. The web is almost violated. It's like someone else has been in my space. But it's very interesting, and you know, some of these notes that people leave behind are meaningless, and some of them are actually cool comments about the material that's there, the information. Another way that we use Web 2.0 is that it tackles the problems of formal learning. And to show you my photo example, here we have a classroom. Actually, I'm not sure if that's a classroom or Steve Jobs' private army, but either way, you can see that that's not really a very conducive learning environment. Having all those people crammed into one place, they're probably more focused on their computers than whatever's going on up here. And nonetheless, that's the learning environment that has developed in universities where formal learning happens. And this really hasn't changed. I mean, this is how we taught people as soon as we could read and write. And that hasn't changed. But what the Web 2.0 is doing is helping us to fix that. One example is the iClicker. This is kind of spreading through universities like wildfire. It's very simple. It's really just a four-button remote response system. And every student in one of those large classes would have one, and it would allow a professor to evaluate the class, take participation, and it kind of brings you back into the to whatever's going on at the front of the room. And it's been very successful so far, and it's just one of those things that makes a big classroom feel small.